I'm going to start by asking you a little bit more about the your involvement in this project, because Crest, clearly the film, you know, there is a certain way in which the film unfolds. There's Crest, you see the Crest campus at the end, and there's a certain kind of investment that Crest has perhaps in the film. And so I just wanted to know, you know, what was your involvement? Had you been involved with them for a while? Were you working with them? Before we move into other questions.
No, I don't have any professional involvement with Crest.
Okay.
My interest was purely from the point of view of trying to understand how caste is understood in an urban environment. People who we normally identify as people who ought to have a certain attitude toward caste.
Mm.
What do they believe in? Mm. So I was trying. I was interested also. I must be honest that trying to problematize our understanding of what political means, and does it only mean that you're only political if you're one particular kind of person? So I had no other I have no other involvement with Crest, and I was trying to also trade a very fine line between saying that, you know, as it comes up, you know, this is all ridiculous, like personality development, but also trying to ask what are the possibilities? Does it have any possibilities? Maybe it does. I don't know.
Mm.
So I didn't want to come from a position, maybe 15 years ago I would have said, I didn't want to come from a position that all this is just utterly ridiculous. I simply no longer know what works, what doesn't work. And I wanted to also bring that tension to the fore, which Vinod actually talks about.
Right.
And maybe if only, you know, the personality development, the female teacher, if only she had been there, the film would have come across as you know, slightly different.
Hmm.
But because Vinod was there, it comes across as something else. So I wanted to leave open that tension.
Yes.
As to what do people think? I beyond that, it wasn't, I didn't want to begin with a specific position saying this is all ridiculous.
In fact, one of the things that I kept thinking when I was watching the film is that, you know, there is, as you rightly pointed out, that there is this tension between what are called the soft performative skills and what you call the slightly superficial, you know, skills of the smile, the handshake, etc. And then, you know, this other kind of involvement. And there is a tension in the school. And yet, I feel that there is this tension that runs through the students as well. So it's not just Crest, but I think that the students themselves are quite invested in getting those skills, because it is a preparation in some ways for the world outside. And it is interesting for us as an audience, and I would be very interested to see what the audience thought of that and how they read it, maybe differently from me.
Yeah.
As to how the, you know, when you're watching it as an audience, what do you feel? I mean, there are sections when I actually squirm, I have to say, that, you know, I kind of, you know, I feel uncomfortable because I'm looking at those and I'm saying why. And yet there is a way in which you don't want to appear patronizing, and I do not want to appear patronizing, because these are skills that, unfortunately, fortunately or unfortunately, when you go out into the world, these, and I can say this, you know, from my own experience of being a professor in a university where we have students from very, very different backgrounds. I don't teach in a private institution. I teach in a public university, which has a very wide range of students who come from very different backgrounds. And I do know that having the lack of English skills, unfortunately, in an institute where I teach technology, is really a factor. You know, it becomes a problem. I mean, and it, how does one then deal with that? So there is a kind of a tension here, even with the students who are kind of struggling, who have very different backgrounds, and yet they go back and each time they're asking their parents, what do you think is the difference? And the parent is saying, well, you know, you're speaking English much better, you're more confident, you know, you're more sorted, and so on and so forth.
No, I agree, and you know, that squirming is something that I was certainly hoping this film would be about.
Mm.
I also squirm when I watch it, even now.
Mm.
Because I think all our positions, say people in this room, are particular kinds of positions. And part of it was, I don't think it's ever completely successful, but to try and understand what it means to have that position and watch people who perhaps have, you know, have a different trajectory. So certainly that that idea of making this filmmaking me uncomfortable is there. I also feel, I still feel uncomfortable when I watch it. But that has to, and that was one of the things that I was, and a film does it much better than a written document.
Right, right. Sure.
Because it has a different different impact on the audience. So, yeah.
Sure. Which brings me to a question which I think is kind of unfair to actually ask you, and Lalit should have been there probably to answer that question, because this is a film made by Lalit Vachani. You know, it is also to do with the style of filming. And this is a film that is coming out of an observational form of filmmaking. And observational cinema has traditionally always been this fly on the wall that actually looks at things without, the only intervention actually comes from you, interestingly. You know, who is in some ways perhaps the filmmaker's voice, but otherwise the camera is kind of looking. It's constantly observing. And part of that, as I said, part of this feeling comes from the fact that the filmmaker is not making an intervention at all. And so it's only about showing us things. And my question then, or rather the question that I'm raising, and again, as I said, it's not a question necessarily only directed to you, and maybe it is a question that we can all talk about later, that what does then observational cinema do when it does not actually intervene? Because then it leaves it open for different people to have different kinds of points of view. So if I, for instance, have a particular point of view, it speaks to me. If somebody else has a different point of view, it speaks to them, and so on and so forth. And so it kind of leaves it open, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, the model that I sort of wanted to follow, I had done, well, I had collaborated with, earlier with the filmmaker David McDougall.
Yes, and David is, yes.
Yeah, on the Dune School,
right.
Films.
Yeah.
And I have to also point out the other person who was also involved. A lot of the film was Priya Sen.
Yes.
So it was a it was a combination of two people and Priya's contribution as well. In terms of what observational, the style does, well, I mean, I think that the whole idea was to leave open, in as much as all films, all documentaries are fictional. I don't mean fictional false, but fiction is constructed, then, you know, like all films are. So at that point of view, the idea was indeed to ask the audience, different kinds of people, what they thought of it. I mean, it's a really, and the, I think for me, I mean, although I'm not, you know, I have some reservations, I think the important thing for me is that it is actually quite a faulty document. Because I didn't really want it something that the audience would immediately know what was being said. You know, it's like the term neoliberalism. If I use the term neoliberalism, everyone knows what it means. Although I don't think anyone really knows what it means. So, so that was the whole point behind it. And David's films are tightly different. I'm not completely in sort of agreement necessarily with that style, but that was the idea. And in terms of whether the intervention of the filmmaker, well, or not, well, that's probably as much as fiction as anything else, and that's fine. But I know, I'd really be interested in thinking what people thought of it. So.
I have to say that I'm a great admirer of David's films, and the Dune School Chronicles is one of my most favorite series of films which I show in class. I have to say that observational cinema has a power as well. The point I'm trying to make is that there is a kind of a tension here. Observational cinema also has this incredible sense of power. It has an incredible power, and you see that power. You know, when you look at them, and you know, there is a section where there is this moment when, you know, they're at the beginning when they're doing their public skills, you know, and they're in the class, and at some point they can't speak in front of the camera, and they go back, and the girls are kind of, you know, curling up in their seats. It's the power of observational cinema, because the camera is able to capture those moments so well. And that is the moment of, that is really the power of observational cinema, which it can do, which is amazing. And a lot of Lalit's films have done that very well as well. So that, I think I must kind of signpost that. The other question that I thought that I would like to ask you is that how was the casting? Because were you part of that? Like, how was the casting? You know, documentary films, even David talks about this in his book on the Dune School Chronicles. He says that documentaries are as casted as any other film. You make a list. A filmmaker makes a list and says, talkative boy, introvert boy, you know, somebody who is extrovert, funny, will probably make for a good subject. And you cast actors in very much the same way for documentary. So how did you decide that you were going to select these students and not these ones?
Most of my work is ethnography. And often when students ask, you know, like they ask things like, what is the ideal sample size? And the only answer to that is really, how long is a piece of string? You know, like, I mean, I don't know. So in a similar sense, like a lot of ethnography, at least it's completely ad hoc. When a book comes out, you think it's some cohesive story that people you've been working on. Mm-hmm. That's completely untrue. It's fortuitous. It's serendipity. In a similar sense, I think we were lucky that we just found a series of characters which we thought cohered. We thought we could structure the story around them. I would say at this point of course, David is right that that's what happens. But I don't know. But you're a filmmaker, Sabina. I thought it was just luck. If these, I don't know if these characters had not been there, perhaps there would have been another story. Mm. I think it's like, I mean, I enjoyed doing this kind of film because it's like fieldwork. It's completely accidental. And that's why you have books that are interesting and some are really boring. I guess that's like a film as well. So it was an accident, and we actually did sit down and then decide who are the characters we would follow. And I wanted also that certain tension between the institution, the life of the institution, and the home, going that back, which is something I've done earlier in another film here, that backwards and forwards. And so my only kind of, you know, to cut a long answer short, is say that it was serendipity, I think. Mm. I don't know what would happen if these, rather than say that, you know, we kind of actually managed to start off with a project which was wonderfully well thought out. Actually, it wasn't that. Mm. We were lucky.
That was a nice section at the end when Nimimol can't do what she... I mean, there's a conflict at home. You know, that's that one interesting moment when, you know, she wants to do something, and this whole gap between what her aspirations are and what the parents feel that she should do. The parents feel she should go out and get a job, which is stable, and she wants to do something else, and she wants to follow her dreams. And that interesting, that there is a kind of an interesting kind of a conflict there. One of the issues with making a documentary is this whole business of this... linear progression, that, you know, you're always making a film where things are moving in a particular kind of direction, and documentary is made out of conflict, documentary is made out of contradiction, documentary is made out of vulnerability, where you don't turn your characters into these absolutely amazing beings, and at the same time they're not victims, they're real people, you know. And a lot of the film actually, unfortunately, in the beginning does fall into that, because they're just people who are kind of part of the process and the system. But what breaks it is the end, which is very interesting for me, because that's that moment when the entire discussion of the play happens. And that's where you actually see their differences. You actually begin to see the cracks. You begin to see how they differ and how they are different. And I just wanted to ask you whether that happened. You know, and this is the bane of documentary, because it's a headache for documentary filmmakers, because this is one of the things that you're always looking out for, like, what is going to be that moment? You know, what are going to be those curves? What is going to be that arc? So what did it happen somewhere in the middle? You know, were you looking out for it? Were you trying to create a situation where something like that happened? I mean, you would know, because you were associated with the project.
Well, it was certainly my idea that you know, not to present them as stereotypic good people or stereotypic bad people.
Of course.
Because as we all know, it's that spectrum along which we all exist. But to follow the entire thing to the life of one course and see what happens.
Right.
And again, I wish I had a sort of a self-promotional answer by saying that yes, we actually planned it, but Dakshin just turned up accidentally, you know, that play. And then it seemed like a good moment. And otherwise, honestly, I don't know what would have happened.
Yeah.
But that's how it panned out. And Dakshin was there. And because of who Dakshin is, the kind of work that he does, it allowed certainly me to think about presenting that precisely that contradiction, that the complexity that all of us have, and how to bring it out in this particular film. And it was again, I think, luck that he turned up. And this is what we ended up doing. And it certainly allowed us to then present people as complex characters and ask the question, what does it mean to be that kind of person, have where people have certain kind of expectations of you, which is kind of beginning of the film. But you also have a sense of, as all of us do, what is it that you want, which is sometimes not in keeping with what, I don't know, what someone else might think is proper politics and whatever. So I did have a sense of kind of what to show. I don't know how, I didn't quite know how it would be done, except perhaps it would have been differently, asking people about issues of caste. That would have been less interesting, I think. What do you think of, I don't know, discrimination and whatever. But I think that allowed us to show it much more graphically, and that's how it worked out. Yeah.
I think what would be a very interesting project would be to revisit, just like Rahul's, you know, 20 years later, because this is such a, it's like a goldfish, no? like a goldfish bowl where they've been put together in this protected environment, and then to see what happens when they actually leave, and because you don't get a sense, you get these single things at the end, but we don't really know what is going to happen. And I would be so curious to know what happens to each one of them when they go out into the world. But that's another project. And thank you so much, Sanjay. And I think the film is so much richer for your presence in this film. I'm going to now open it up to the audience. So if people have questions, comments.
How did the students relate to each other? There was this, because I don't know what it is to choose to join an institution for a certain purpose that sort of is meant for a social elevation like that. There was this section when they were talking about non-Keralite and Bengali, and perhaps that was one way to point out prejudice even amongst communities that you think you relate to in terms of solidarity. And they are college students, they are postgraduate students who come with an awareness of the issue in terms of some ideas of hostility or solidarities that they've picked up over time. Were there others they saw even between themselves? How did they relate to each other?
As the film, I think, depicts, they related to each other quite well. But again, that's only the film. I mean, in the sense that is any document, a book, a film is a particular kind of document, gives you a particular kind of picture. And the point behind the film towards the ending was to exactly ask, or maybe open up that idea of, what do these relationships mean? How do people come to these relationships? Are they only, do they relate to each other simply because there's some kind of community solidarity? And what does community solidarity actually mean in a current environment? Because see, any traditional political position would be, automatically would be, there's something called a community of the oppressed. But within that, what are the experiences that people have in their everyday lives that don't allow us to necessarily have this happy picture of a cohesive community? Sometimes that's why at least Sabina and I also squirm. I mean, I still squirm when I watch it, because it, that question, that easy acceptance of the notion that there will be an automatic response from certain kind of people, it's not there. I mean, it doesn't happen.
I would actually, my position would be that I both squirm in some sections and I understand it. You know, I really don't think that I would take a hard line position and say that I squirm only. Sanjay, I do think that the film has a lot of power, and I really do think that, you know, to say that we cannot have community enterprises, or rather, I'm trying to find the right word, you know, situations like this is something that I wouldn't agree with, because then we are saying that nothing can work. I mean, the kids seem to have a lot of fun. They seem to have made friends with each other. They seem to have developed relationships with each other. They have been, I mean, clearly when you look at them, you know, the fact that they're having a lot of fun when they're doing the street plays. They, you know, there's a lot of confidence after a while when they're leaving. You can see Reshma's face when she gets that prize. I mean, that's not performance for the camera. I mean, you can see that, you know. I mean, there is performance, of course. All documentaries have performance, right? And the point that you made about the conversation that they have about the, you know, the Bengali migrants, that's real life. We all have prejudices, you know. And what happens is they come up with all their prejudices, which are terrible in the beginning. And then there's a conversation with Joy. And then by the end of it, there is, we don't see enough of it, but clearly there is something, you see the play and the play is actually saying something entirely different from what they were actually articulating at the beginning. So there is a kind of a way in which, and we are all shaped by those institutions, right? We go to schools, we go to colleges, we go to different kinds of institutions where we are shaped by that, and we all come with certain prejudices. So I think that the answer would be a little more, would be more complex.
I think the idea was more behind to think of identity itself not as completely cohesive or easy to understand, but always contingent. Then in a specific moment, why do you behave? Which of course doesn't mean that we don't experience happiness or friendship,
sure,
but that it all happens in fraught situations, and that's what happens. And that's what the idea was to explore in this particular film.
I wonder what this film would have been. Just a question, it's a rhetorical question, if it didn't have the experts. You know, we've got subject experts. So we've got the Vinod and we've got the Joy and we've got the other people. What if this had been a film just about the kids, you know, these children and these young people. I can't call them kids. These young Dalit people, you know, Adivasi and Dalit, people, young people. And them talking about being in this institution. And I wonder, because what happens is we keep coming back to the NGO format of having the subject experts speak. So just a question. I'm leaving it open.
You're right. I mean, that was the point. The point is precisely that, I keep going back, trying to work through that tension. There are certain kinds of people who have questions, you, me, Vinod, and there is the other broader context. And so I guess it would have been a different kind of a film, but perhaps not necessarily. The thing with ethnography, unlike doing history, is that you are part of the problem. Like in history, you are not necessarily part of the problem because you can distance yourself from the archive and say, obviously you're looking at some other era. But that's not true of a film, a documentary film. Of necessity, you're part of the problem. You're part of that context, right? So we know you, me, whoever are part of that world. And I think it would have been a different kind of film. I don't have any kind of long sort of cohesive answer to that.
I think Subhashree is now looking at me in a kind of a desperate way. So I think we have to wind up. But thank you very much, Sanjay. Thanks very much for this.